All right, I'd like to introduce someone. She's a native of Middletown. Very wonderful person. I don't know if you want to read off of this. I just want to move my heart. When I first met her, she was very inspiring, very caring, the perfect person to do this. The perfect person, I'm sorry. And it's such an honor. To me, it's such an honor. She's such a sweet person. I'd like to introduce Ms. Zenobia Dyson.
And fear is multidimensional, meaning it has different features. And it gives us an illusion that affects us in different ways. For me, fear was a mind killer. And when a person experiences a terrifying experience, it constantly plays on a person's mind. Fear gives us the impression of contagiousness because it takes effect. It takes shape in our lives and it has a heavy influence. Now, the law of physics says momentum equals mass times velocity. So, what is that? Let me put that in layman terms. Energy equals strength or quantity times speed. Right here, if you want to write that down.
Come on.
Means that fear can be a mighty mass forcing you to make excuses instead of making progress.
Praise the Lord.
See, I believe God is using this same equation to place us into a situation to show us the difference between strength and power.
Come on.
Y'all staying with me? All right. So, if there's a difference between force and momentum, which is time, and our mind determines the length of time to bring fear to death when it's under the action or under the influence of a constant force. Now, when God dwells in length, he dwells in width, he dwells in height, and he dwells in depth. So we cannot confine an infinite God to time.
Come on now.
All right, so when you're dealing with fear, you can't say, well, I want to get out of it today. I want to do it right now, but then you still go back to the same old you.
Come on.
So you cannot confine God to time. So here's the question. Why do people tend to gravitate or fall into a cave? Into a cave state mentality. Why? Think about that. And how do we eradicate fear? How do we kick out fear? How do we knock fear down? How do we bring fear to its knees? Okay? Because at some point in time in our lives, we will approach to the cave experience. And it's not if we approach it, it's when we approach it. Now, I know when I'm approaching to a spiritual cave in my life, the most important thing to do is, what to do, and what is equally important to do is what not to do. We have to know that. So some of you may be asking yourselves, what is the motivation for a person finding themselves in a cave? And if you're asking yourself this question, then you're asking yourself a very good question. First of all, financial stress. And you all can identify with that. From losing your job, brokenness in the home, such as divorce or an abusive relationship, broken dreams, ailments in our body that is causing weakness and frustration, even a loss of a family member. Now, there are many reasons, but that's just to name a few. But a cave can be a good thing, and a cave can be a bad thing. It depends on the reasons why a person is entering into a cave. Now, a cave, if you look at it right here, it can be used for safety or be used for a prison. Now, why can caves be used for a prison or used for safety? Structurally, it's safe. It's a hard rock. It protects you from the outside components. It's easy to disappear in the darkness when you walk inside that cave. No one can see you.
Come on.
And the reason why a cave can become a prison of life. We are outreached from people or self-punishment. We punish ourselves. It becomes a personal bubble. And we are keeping people at a distance when we hide in the cave. We isolate ourselves in the cave. Now, it happens to all of us from time to time when life seems so too demanding. Now, extracting or removing a person out of a cave can be difficult. Have you ever thought about that? When somebody having a hard time and you try to tell them, it's all right, it'll be okay, you'll get over it, you'll make it, girl. But it ain't that easy. It's hard to get somebody out of the cave. Okay, because sometimes those words just don't work. They need to sit in that cave just a little while longer just to hear God talking to them.
Amen. That's right.
See, there are many complications coming out of the cave. And individuals need time to deal with the shock of a situation.
Yes.
See, the complication could be a routine injury, but the treatment is required. And the reason why I speak, because I lived in a cave for 22 years of my life. For 22 years, I lived with depression. For 22 years, I lived in this cave. For 22 years, I was molested by my father at the age of 8 years old, and I hid in this cave. Somebody talk to me up here. And here is my battle. It was my permanent residence. It was my final resolution. I was afraid to face my fears. I learned in that cave how to suppress my pain. I learned how to mask my pain. I learned how to keep my pain a secret. Think about that. See, this was the negative side effects of living in the cave. See, when you are depressed, you hear me? When you are depressed, frustrated, discouraged, and everything seems out of sorts, and everything seems wrong, we only can see the negative side of the cave.
Come on.
Come on.
Mm. Come on, baby. And God doesn't want us to walk out that cave sideways. He wants us to walk right on out that cave, straight forward, looking at it, face everything in wise. Face everything in wise. Hallelujah. I know it's not supposed to be a church event, but I'm going with my flow here.
Come on, man.
Come on, come on. That's all right.
See, the weeds that grows around the cave, those are distractions, and those are a negative side effect too.
Yes.
That's called neglect. When we don't treat those weeds in the yard, in the garden, what they do? They choke the plants, they choke the flowers, don't they? And guess what? They compete for water, they compete for sunlight, they compete for nutrients. Everything you compete for is all the weeds. And the weeds will reduce us to our lowest quality. The weeds will compete us with everything. See, the weeds want God's system. Just like the weeds take over the natural system. Right? So if we don't eliminate those weeds, it will choke us to death. And that's what fear is doing to us. Choking us to death.
Yes.
If we allow it.
Amen.
So sisters and brothers, I'm advising you today, don't let your purpose be displaced. You need to snap out of it and undecorate your cave. Because something is trying to cap you out, or something is trying to put a cap on your gift. Come on, can I get some feedback up here? Because fear, F-E-A-R, is not just face everything in rise. It's false evidence appearing real.
Come on, man.
When you're in that cave, the enemy will make it so that they don't like me. I can't do this. I can't do that. I don't know how I get there. I ain't got no money. Everything is I can't and I won't.
Come on, come on. Lord, have mercy.
But if you believe and move them weeds,
right,
and put spray that weed killer down there, you can start to see some stuff.
Right.
You can start to say, you know what? I walked in that cave and I can walk out of that cave.
Come on.
And guess what? F-E-A-R, fear. Fight erring allowance radically. What does that mean? When you let allowances come into your life, negative allowances come into your life, domestic violence, sexual abuse, worry, stress, bills, co-workers, family, church people, whatever it is, let's keep it real, whatever it is, you fight those negative allowances radically.
Yes.
See, there is something called creative outlets.
That's right.
And we suffer from trauma, or there is a strain in our lives and we can't stop thinking about it. Some people use different substances to cope. Drugs, alcohol, gambling, sex, whatever it is, okay? So fight every allowance radically means that there has been a doubtful account. That means we have given a rise to this account. In our life that has been uncollectible, meaning incapable of being collected. So we need to start adding credits to what is owed to us. So do you want a return on your happiness? We all want a return on our happiness. We all want what belongs to us. We want our birthright. See, when we give allowances to things, that means a legal right. We gave it a legal right in our life. So they give me, they tell me I gotta hurry up, so let me skip this. It's my vision, they tell me to hurry up. All right. So poetry became my outlet for me at the age of 8 years old. And here are my circumstances. I was sexually molested by a close family member. I seen my mother go through domestic violence. I was a victim of domestic violence. I had been bullied. I had fatal thoughts of suicide. I was depressed. I was homeless. I was unemployed. I was in a hypothermic state of mind. I was living in fear. See, being out in the cold elements will cause your mind to go into a shock. And that's the hibernation of the cave that will force you to go into this deep sleep during the winter months. Now everything is dormant during the winter months. Your mind is inactive, but your situation is sending you lullabies, echoing your problems repeatedly in your head. So this is the treatment I received in the cave. See, then you become accustomed to your living arrangements, and metaphorically, you made a home in this cave. You feel like no one can hurt you in this cave, and you're safe in this cave, and then this cave makes you think that this is your relief. In this cave, your body temperature drops to match the outside elements, and your heart